this morning about foundations. Foundations. Where do you build your foundation? What are you building your foundation on? I heard a story once about a man who was driving in a car and he was going through Ohio University. Now, I try to keep Ohio out of all of my messages, but this morning this illustration was too good to pass up. Now, he was driving through Ohio University at a time when they were building this building for their art institute. And my understanding is that this place is supposed to really show modern day art. In its construction of the building, it's supposed to really show some abstract art. And so the architect who was working on the building made stairways that absolutely go nowhere. They're just random staircases. He made pillars in the building that hold and don't support anything. They're just totally random. And so as this man was driving past this structure, and the person driving the car was telling him about this art building, he said to the man, he said, "Well, my question for you is the foundation the same as the rest of the building?" And the man driving the car said, "Well, no, you can't make a foundation like that." You see, a foundation has to be solid. It has to be built on the rock. And as we're continuing this message of keeping Jesus, I want to turn in our Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. We're going to go right to the end of the Sermon on the Mount. We're not going to wrap things up personally as a church with the Sermon on the Mount, but this is the direction where we're going to go this morning. And we're going to go to the end where Jesus is wrapping up the sermon. And in Matthew chapter 7, in verse 24, Jesus, if you remember, he is talking to a group of people. He is at the base of this mountain or somewhat on the mountain, and he's sitting down, and he's been sharing and teaching the people. And he's about to wrap up his message, and he shared all kinds of concepts. We've talked of three of them so far, and Jesus is going to wrap it up, and he says this in verse 24, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house. Yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who built his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell with a great crash." Jesus talks about two men, one foolish, one wise. And he gives a comparison. He says, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man. And then he says, but everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish man. You know, Jesus is really talking to all of us who have heard the message, heard the teachings of Jesus. Maybe you've grown up in church and you've heard the messages of Jesus. Maybe you've read through your Bible and you've read through the New Testament and you've read the message of Jesus. Maybe you have a red letter Bible and you've gone through and you've read all of Jesus' teachings that are in red in your Bible. Jesus is talking to you and me this morning. If you're visiting with us, you've never been to church before, you've never read your Bible, you've never read the New Testament, you've never heard the teachings of Jesus, you've never heard the preachings, I got good news for you this morning. You're off the hook. You are off the hook. Jesus is not talking to you, but I would encourage you to pay attention. Pay close attention, because listen to what Jesus says happens to the person who hears his teachings and obeys it. He says, the one who does is like the wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall, because it had its foundation on the rock. You know, listen, the storms of life, they're going to come. No doubt you've experienced the storms of life. The winds of trouble, they're going to blow against your life and who you are. Listen, they're going to come. Satan would like nothing more than to huff and puff and blow your house down. Satan is here to destroy you and your life. Make no doubt about it. Satan is here to destroy you. And the question for you and me is, where have we built our foundation? Are you and me, are we on the rock? Jesus lets us know. He says, the one who is on the rock does not fall. But listen to his actual words. The words of Jesus are, he says, the one who built his house on the rock. The one who built his house on the rock. It's past tense. The one who built his house on the rock will not fall. There's got to be a point where you build. So maybe you're in the building process now. But maybe you've been a Christian for a long time. Let me ask you a question. Where did you build? Jesus says, the one who built his house on the rock. You know, there's a lot of foundations we can build our lives on. We can build our lives on our finances. We can build our lives based on a relationship. We can build our lives based on a career that we're pursuing. We can build our lives based on an addiction that's our go-to, our fallback. You know, you can build your life on yourself. I know a lot of people who don't trust others. A lot of people who are not counting on anybody else. They just trust themselves. That's their foundation. That's their go-to. Their gut instinct is what they pursue. That's their foundation. But listen to me, all of those foundations can be stolen from your life. Every single one of those can be swept away in the storm of life. You can lose your job and there goes your career. Your relationship could fall apart, and there goes that foundation. It's swept away. Your health could go wrong, and it could go bad very quickly. I've seen it happen over and over again, and there's no foundation there, and it's swept away. But Jesus says, the one who hears my word, puts them into practice, builds their foundation on the rock. Have you put your foundation on the rock? You know, I think sometimes when I hear this, I think a lot of Christians, especially in America today, we are Christian tourists. We're Christian tourists, and this is what I mean by that. How many of you guys have ever been on a really good vacation where you've toured either a state across the United States or you've gone different places and you've gone on your own personal tour? You've driven around, you've seen the coast, you've seen mountains, maybe you went and saw the Grand Canyon and you went on a tour, right? And any good tour, even if it's your own tour, has great scenery. You might be looking at the ocean, maybe the Great Lakes, maybe the Grand Canyon, and I'll tell you what you do. You do what any good American would do. When you get to that place, you don't look out the window of your car and say, well, that was nice, and then punch the gas and leave. No, you see the scenery, you see this beautiful place, and you look for the highest point or the best point to be able to see that view. And most likely it's going to be a huge rock, a big boulder, a big something that stands out there, and you're going to go out to that place and you're going to get on that rock with your friends or your family or whoever you're with, and you're going to look at the scenery and you're going to take pictures. And then you're going to turn around. You're going to smile with that person, and somebody else is going to get a camera, and you're going to hope you find some other tourist who's there, and you're going to say, hey, would you take a picture of us? And you're going to smile on that rock, right, with the beautiful scenery behind you. You see it now in your head because chances are good you have those pictures at home. You've climbed up on some wall that said, please do not climb up on this wall. And you've stood up there and taken your scenery picture, right? You climbed up on the big old rocks and you went past the coastline sign that said, please don't go past this sign. It's dangerous out there. And you went out there anyways and took the picture. Are you with me? Why? Because you want to get out there. It's better out there. And that's what we do a lot of times as Christians. We treat church, we treat, you know, revival services, we treat services like that. We just want to come and see what God is doing. We may want to experience it. We may want to, you know, get a mental picture. This was a good moment with God. This was a powerful experience. It was beautiful. It was amazing. You should have been there. In fact, you know what? Let's go there together. Me and you, we'll go next week. And we come, and that's good, and that's great. And we make a mental image of it in our mind, of the experience that we had, and we leave. But there's no building a foundation there. There's no building on it. It's just an experience. And God is faithful, and He gives us the experience, but that doesn't mean that you have a solid foundation. The winds are going to come, the storms are going to come, and guess what? You're going to fall. It's going to happen. And then, but maybe you're the Christian, you're like us, we've become campers. We campers, we bought this nice camper, you know, we're going to go camping, we're going to experience Michigan, we're going to experience these beautiful states here, and we're going to go take our kids, and we're going to go camping, and you know, there's a lot of Christians that we like to set up camp. We set up camp, but there's still not a foundation. You see, the camping Christian is the type of Christian who still makes their relationship with God. It's not a foundation on the rock, it's on wheels. This is just one of the many adventures in my life. Christianity is kind of one of the many things. My relationship with God is one of the many things that I put my foundation on. This, today, it's Sunday morning, so I'm camped out here on my religious campsite, on my Holy Ghost experience. I'm camped out here, and we're going to stay here a while. I brought my kids, I brought my stuff, and we're going to be here for a while. But tomorrow, tomorrow, that foundation is going to shift. Because tomorrow I got to shift to my career, or I got to shift to this, or I'm going to be with this group of people, or you know what I'm talking about. And you shift. And the foundation shifts. And when the storms of life come, let me tell you something. I don't know where you're parked. And if you're not parked in the right place, you're going to fall. In fact, if I get to choose what I'm in during a big storm, it's not going to be a tent and it's not going to be a camper. It's going to be a solid house with a solid foundation. Amen? And so we got to build our house on a solid foundation. You know, even I think as good Christians, we misinterpret this message. We go through the storms of life and we feel that my trust, my hope, my belief in Jesus will keep me from falling. You know, this is the message that's radiating through the American church. It's an easy message. It's easy to accept. It makes Christianity very easy. And yes, you might be saved. And yes, you might not be going to heaven or hell, and you might be going to heaven, but listen to me, it doesn't mean you're not going to fall in this life, because those are not Jesus' words. Jesus did not say, those who hear my words, trust in me, put their hope in me, believe in me, will not fall, did he? He didn't say that. He said, those who hear these words of mine and put them into practice is like the wise man who built his house on the rock. Wow. Everyone say input. Input. We're going to talk about input this morning. Input. Input, my definition of input for this sake of this sermon is when you hear the message, when you hear the teachings of Jesus, when you read the scriptures, and so in a sense you hear them, it's you taking that message and putting it inside you. That's input. When you've read it, so you've seen it, or you hear it, so you know, so you're listening to it, and you put it inside you. That's input. Okay, that's input. That's God's word inside us. Now, thinking of input, listen. The purpose of Scripture, the purpose of the Word of God is not to inform you. God is not looking to give you a bunch of more information. The purpose of Scripture is to transform you. God is not looking to inform you. God is looking to transform you. There's a lot of good information out there, but that information is not going to transform you like God wants the Word of God to do. And the first step in the transformation is God wants to inform you. He wants you to hear the message. He wants you to read the message. He wants you to get in the Word of God and understand the message so that it can be input in your life. And when you take that input and you power it with the power of the Holy Spirit and you apply it to your life, it begins to transform you. You're not the same anymore. You're not the same anymore. When you take that input and you apply it to your life, you're not the same anymore. You're the same person, but you're very different. It's the Saul to Paul experience. You know, I don't have a lot of teenagers here this morning. There's a few here, so this illustration might fall flat, but the teenagers are on their winter retreat. But if you've seen the movie Transformers, Optimus Prime, right? Think of Optimus Prime. He has two states that he gets in. He's got his big semi-truck mode, and then he's got his transformed robot mode where he is ready to take on the enemy, right? Same robot, very different. One is it can do the routine daily stuff in the semi-truck mode. The other transforms him into this robot that the enemy has to reckon with. You see, God is wanting to take you from one mode and transform you into a new mode. God does not want to leave you the same. God understands that you are capable of way more than you are doing right now. God knows that, but he knows that you need the Scriptures in you in order to begin the transformation. Everybody say output. You know, this is the whole emphasis on Jesus' teaching in Matthew chapter 7, 24 through 27. He says that you have heard the message. Now what are you going to do with the message? This is the output part. This is where we put into practice the things we've learned through input. You know, it seems so easy. It's an easy concept, input, output. In fact, you know, I've been praying all week about, God, what message I'm going to bring today. And when this message began to form, I thought, man, God, give me something with a little more pizzazz. You know, give me something a little more deep. Give me a little more fire and brimstone. And I really felt the Holy Spirit said the church today is not ready for it because it doesn't understand the importance of input and the power of output. He said the church today is weak and it's lazy because there is no output. The church in America is all about input. I'll prove it to you. Go in any church library, any church bookstore, you're going to find a whole lot of input. But look at the American church. We're weak in the output. We're weak in the output. We've become lazy with the output, and this is what the Holy Spirit showed me. He said, listen to me, that the Word, the Scriptures, the Word of God becomes powerless when all we do is put it in and there is no output. We limit the power of God when we just allow it to be input and it never becomes output. You see, transformation only happens when we put into practice what we have learned through input. The output is the actual putting into practice what's been input. And all too often, we get confused with the output. We think, well, if I've learned it, if I can explain it, if I can debate it, if I can share it with you, then that's enough. But that's not what Jesus says. Jesus says, when we put it into practice, that's the output. If you don't put into practice the input, then it's all in vain. Did you hear me? If we don't put it into practice, then it's all in vain. If all you do is read the scriptures and hear the teachings and hear the preachings, but never do anything with it, it's all in vain. It's all powerless. It's all just a bunch of information. The church becomes powerless. The Holy Spirit, in essence, becomes powerless because God uses the Holy Spirit through us. So he becomes powerless, and now all of a sudden we've taken God and we've put him in a box. We've put him there. He does not want to be in the box. And you say, well, he could do anything he wants. Yes, he can, but for whatever reason, he chooses to use us. And so we, when we take God and we put him in the box, we are restraining what God can do in our church, in our communities, and in our lives. You know, I heard one pastor, he was talking about a similar topic, and he said, listen, it's easy for people to get puffed up when they have a lot of knowledge of the scripture. It's easy for them to get puffed up and arrogant, but he says, what happens when I take a pin and I pop that person? All I get is a bunch of puff and no stuff. I thought, that's good. What comes out of me when you pop me? Is it stuff or a bunch of puff? God is looking for the stuff. He's looking for the stuff. You say, well, I know a whole lot of stuff about Scripture. Well, so does God. He wrote it. He did it all. He's not looking for you to know a bunch more stuff. He's looking for you to do stuff. He's looking for you to be active, living and active Christians. We cannot be lazy with this. You know, as a hunter, I would relate this to like having a beautiful rifle and buying the most expensive ammunition and loading that rifle and then putting it in a gun safe and locking it up. And if you told me I had to go to war and you said, I'll give you two rifles, I'll give you this rifle that's not loaded, or I'll give you that rifle that is loaded, but the loaded one has to stay in the safe. You know which one I'm going to pick every time? The unloaded one, because at least I can hit you with it. I can't do anything with that loaded rifle that's locked up in the safe. And I think right now what's happening across America is God is saying, I'm finding people that want to be used. They're lacking in power because they don't have the Holy Spirit. But there's a group of people that are saying, we will be used. And then there's the Christian church. And the Christian church has all the power, all the authority, all of the ability, all of the knowledge of Scripture. But we just want more input. We want more input of knowledge. We want more input of the Holy Spirit. We want more outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You know, we're gluttons for it. We want it. And then there's a group of people over here, just good people. They don't have the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're not saved. They're not serving Jesus. They're just good people with a heart to serve and a heart to do something. You don't think God's going to use them? God's going to use them. He'll use them to minister to his people. He'll use them to feed the hungry. He'll use them to heal the sick. He'll use them. God will use them because they're a resource to minister to his people. He'll use them. But he wants to use those who have the power of the Holy Spirit moving with them so that it's empowered work of the ministry and so that when they help people or do something good on earth, it points people not just to more good people, but it points people to Jesus Christ. Are we getting it? God wants a church that's full of power. And you can be full of a lot of information, but unless you're willing to use it, it's powerless. Listen, I'm going to turn up the thermostat a little bit. And this next little bit is just should wake up the church, I hope. The altar call this morning is going to be a pretty broad net. It's for all of us who have gotten lazy with the input. You know, we can have a great head knowledge of who God is and the Word of God. You can trust Jesus. You can love Jesus. You can worship Jesus. But the truth is, Do you know the teachings of Jesus, but still choose to not put them into practice in your life? Do you skirt the edges? Do you make up excuses? Do you justify your actions? Do you explain away the reasons why you don't need to obey? Because if you do, my heart breaks for you, because you're not on the rock. You say, well, yeah, I am. I trust in Jesus. He is the rock. Jesus said, the man who built his house upon the rock, the man who built it, the man who built it is the man who hears my teachings and puts them into practice. Salvation comes through confession and believing, right? I believe that scripture. I believe the scriptures that tell us, that say to you and me, you are saved when you believe in your hearts and you confess with your mouths that Jesus is Lord. Listen, there's input and there's output in that statement. There's input where I've heard the message of Jesus Christ. I've heard that Jesus has died on the cross for my sins. I've heard that there's only one way to the Father, and that's through Jesus Christ. I've heard that I need to surrender my life to Him. I need to ask for forgiveness and repentance. I've heard that. That's the input. Something inside me stirs me to say, I want to respond to God. And so then, what is the output? I confess with my mouth. There is output there, right? And in that moment, the Bible says that you're saved. So if you're here this morning and you believe and you've made that confession, the Bible says that you are saved. Does that mean that when the storms of life come, that you'll be the wise man who built his house on the rock? No. It means when the storms of life come, you may fall. You may stumble. And you know what? If you're not going to be a Christian who's willing to build your house on the rock, a person who's willing to put into practice the teachings of Jesus, let me encourage you, you better be a praying Christian. You better be a person that trusts a whole lot in God. Because God is still able to save you. God is still able to redeem you. God is still able to take you out of that situation. God is still faithful. He's still love. God is all of those things. God is for you, so God loves you. But you're going to have some rocky days. When the storms of life come, you're going to get wiped out. And the storms of life are going to come. And you're going to get wiped out. And it's going to be a rough ride. So you better be praying. You better be on your knees. Because you really, that's the only choice I see besides taking the teachings of Jesus and applying them to my life and practicing them. You know, and I love that word practice. I love that Jesus chose that word practice. I may not be interpreting this perfectly, but for me, I love that word practice because it tells me today I'm going to practice. I may not get it right. It may not be perfect. But today, I get to practice. And tomorrow, I get to practice more. And if you say, Pastor Ralph, you're really good at that, but I struggle with that. It's only because I've had a little more practice than you. And I've practiced a little longer maybe, or a little harder, or I've put in a little more effort. That's the only reason. Not because I'm better than you. Not because I don't struggle like you. Not because of any of those things. I'm human just like anybody else. But practice. You know, I love looking at the saints who have been, you know, in this for a long time. And I look up to them and I wonder, how did they do this? And they'll tell you the storms of life have come. And they're probably still in some storms. But they'll tell you they've had a lot of practice. They've been walking out the teachings of Jesus. So are we on the rock? Are we on the rock? Are we allowing God to do a transforming work within us? Or are we just playing games with the input? God's always looking for obedience. You know, maybe you think this morning, you think, Pastor Rob, I just totally don't agree with that. I think I'm okay. I think it's all good. I think I'm okay with, you know, there is a strong preaching for grace, and I believe in grace. I believe God is faithful, and His grace is more than enough for all of us today. But it doesn't eliminate us walking out the teachings of Jesus. If it did, Jesus would have never taught anything. He would have just came and died on the cross. I can't throw out the rest of Scripture because of grace. That's just a nugget. It's just a nugget. It's an awesome nugget. Trust me. It's a great nugget, and I'm so thankful every day that I wake up and God's pouring out His grace, amen, and His mercy, and it's more than enough for me today, Scripture says. So no matter how bad I screw up today, it's more than enough for me today. Thank you, Jesus. I need His grace all the time, but that's just a nugget. I still have to wake up and practice the teachings of Jesus. Listen to the words of Jesus found in Matthew 7:21. Just before these chapters, or just before this passage that I read to you earlier, says this: not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoa! Time out! Wait a minute! That's not what I learned in Sunday school! Woo! Break! Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Wow. Jesus, help us. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons? And in your name perform miracles? Then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoers. Whoa. Listen to me. There is power in the name of Jesus. God will speak through whoever He wants. So if He feels His message needs to go forth, He'll use an unbeliever, He'll use an evildoer, He used a donkey in the Old Testament. God will speak through whoever He wants because He wants His name to be proclaimed. Jesus' name drives out demons. At the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, the Bible says. There is authority in the power of Jesus. So anybody who uses the name of Jesus in the proper way will drive out demons. Because there's power in the name of Jesus. And then he says, in your name, perform many miracles. You think Jesus doesn't want to heal? He wants to heal. He wants to touch. He wants to do things. And he has the power to do it, and if somebody's willing to do it. But then Jesus says this statement, but you can do all of those things in my name. Why? Because there's power in the name of Jesus, and still miss the boat, if you will, because he says it's only the one who does the will of my Father. Man, it brings me back to that practice, right? Practice, because I know tomorrow I'm probably going to mess up, and the next day I'm probably going to mess up, and the next day I'm probably going to mess up, and the next day I'm probably going to stumble, and the next day maybe I'll get it all right, and it's all going to be perfect, and it's all going to be grand, and then the next day it's okay, and then the next day I fall, and then the next day it's like, maybe, I'm not quite sure, you know? And I'm going to have those moments in my life. And then I got to ask myself, am I doing the will of the Father? Well, all I got to do really is ask myself, am I obeying the teachings of Jesus? And when I realize I'm not, am I asking for forgiveness? And am I having a heart of repentance? Repentance is turning from those things, running from those things, and running after God. That's repentance. And there's grace in that repentance. See, I think we want to pollute grace. We want to make grace whatever we want to make it. Grace is there. Forgiveness is there. Mercy is there. Okay? I'm a pretty merciful guy most of the time. But if you are stealing from me, if you come up here and you start taking my wallet, I'm probably going to stop you. And say, what are you doing? And you say, well, I'm sorry, I just couldn't resist. I'm a thief, I can't resist. Okay, just stop right now. And if you keep reaching in my pocket, I'm gonna slap your hand, and I'm gonna call the ushers and say, get this guy out of here before he steals from everybody. There's gonna be punishment there, but if you stop, there's grace. You see what I'm saying? There's grace. That's real repentance. If you're just still grabbing my wallet and saying, I'm sorry, that's not repentance. I'm sorry too. Hey, just let's be real for a moment. Let's view it the way God views it. How does He view it? His heart longs for you. He longs for you. He loves you. He is for you. I'm going to wrap this up. Input. Everyone who hears these words of mine, output, and puts them into practice will be like the wise man who built his house upon the rock. You know, James gives us a different visual picture. He says in James 2, 22 through 27, and I close with this, "Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is like this." He gives an example. He says, it's like this, "to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." Wow. You see, God is not looking to just pour into you. He's looking to pour out of you. That's why He gives us the Holy Spirit. He gives us the Holy Spirit. It's input. I'm going to talk about this next week. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the fruits of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit, because that's all about output. You know, the Bible says that God didn't just give us the Holy Spirit to be with us. The Bible says that He put Him in us. That's a hard concept to wrap our head around. But you see, that's the input, because God is looking for greater output. On my own, I don't create enough output to pursue or to fulfill God's will for my life on this earth. But with the Holy Spirit, I create all kinds of output. With the Holy Spirit, He gives me the gifts that are needed to minister to His people. And with His output, I get the fruits of the Spirit as well. And we're going to talk about those next week. God is all looking for output. So let's evaluate in just a moment. I'm going to ask the servers to come and we're going to take communion. Paul talks about taking communion. He says, evaluate your life. Evaluate your heart. Evaluate your relationship with Jesus. Evaluate where you're standing with God right now. And we're going to take communion. So it's important that we evaluate our lives. I wish I had had more time to illustrate this. I would have had mirrors all up across the stage, so that the whole time I was preaching, you would be looking at yourself in the mirror. Because that's what James says. Look at yourself. Look at yourself in the mirror and don't forget who you are. And don't forget what you're capable of. And don't forget, but evaluate your life. And so we got to evaluate, what am I doing with the input? Is God wanting to do greater things with my life than I'm allowing Him to do, because I'm just a consumer and not a giver? And listen, again, God is gracious. He is forgiving. I'm right there in this boat with you. I'm practicing every day as best I can, and I don't get it right all the time. And I mess up, and sometimes I feel like I have to run suicides because of it. You know, you ever run a suicide in practice? The worst drills. And you got to run from, you know, the out of bounds to the free throw line, and then to half court, and then to the other free throw line, and then full court, and all the way back. And it just seems like as soon as you get back, the coach blows the whistle again, and you're doing it again, and it's hard, and you're tired, and you're worn, and there's so many times in my life where I'm there. I'm just like, God, it's hard. This Christian life is is hard. I'm having a hard time fighting the flesh. I'm having a hard time making the right decisions. I'm having a hard time giving when you're asking me to give. God, I'm struggling, but I'm here at this practice and I'm laying it all out there, and God in his grace gives me a water break. And he lets me take a break. And I just sit in his presence and he just pours into me through his Holy Spirit. And it's in that place that I discover his forgiveness. It's in that place that I discover his grace. It's in that place where I receive things I don't deserve. It's in that place where I receive more of the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. And it renews me and it strengthens me and it refreshes me. And maybe you need that today. Maybe you need a little more input from God today. Well, I encourage you, take a water break. Take a time out and evaluate your life and evaluate what you're doing. And I'm not saying this morning that you're not a Christian. I'm not saying this morning that you're not saved. I'm not saying any of those things, but I'm saying when the storms of life are going to come, your rock is built in one place, and that's on the teachings of Jesus Christ and whether you put them into practice in your life. Maybe you're going through the storm and things are real shaky right now. We're here to pray for you. After we're done taking communion, Pastor Bill's going to come and we're going to invite the elders to come and we're going to open up these altars and we're going to ask you that you just come and we're going to encourage with you and pray with you and believe that God will refresh you today. But servers, would you go ahead and serve the communion? And as they're doing that, I want you to evaluate, begin to think. Begin to ask for repentance and begin to ask for God's grace. They serve.